Anyway. Okay. Hello, everyone. For those who are wondering, what is this? Well, this is Zoom Hope Live. I thought that, you know, when we look around us and see what is happening, it is a situation that needs to be addressed. What is happening? COVID-19 is literally wreaking havoc upon the earth. And not just on the earth, terrain itself, but let's be more realistic. It is affecting human beings. Not just with the sickness. There are those who have died from it. There are those who have contracted the pandemic. For those who have not, and for those who are living with it, there is an alarming level of fear and anxiety, apprehension that this still brings. And I thought that it would be good to join, you know, the myriad of people out there who are trying to do the thing in the corner to infuse hope in a hope, what seemingly a hopeless situation. You know, there are a lot of changes that has come as a result of this pandemic. And joining me today in our first Hope Live is Dr. Peter Joseph. He's a pastor in the South Bahamas Conference. And then also we have Pastor Asher Duncan, a pastor in the Ontario Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. It's so good to have my mentor and my good friend. There are others we're trying to get to just have a friendly interaction to infuse hope in what we're having here. But gentlemen, we have both of you, and it's good, and I'm looking forward to us having a good discussion. Welcome.
Yes. Thank you, Pastor Green.
Yeah. Amen. Yes, Green, thanks much.
Okay. People are joining us on Facebook. So I want to speak to you in particular. Just in case you have any comment, and I can stream it, and I can have my guest to, you know, answer it to the best that they can. But I want to get this thing out of the park. It's not a punto final. We're gonna be at this more than once. But in the COVID-19 environment, with social isolation, you're not with your friends. Work as usual. How has it been for you for the past couple of weeks?
Yeah, well, good afternoon, Green, Pastor Green. Good afternoon, Pastor Asher Duncan. Good afternoon, the vast number of people out there as we try to grapple with what we call a new reality. Personally, it's been quite a dramatic shift for me personally. Anybody who knows me knows that I like to be around people, right? I like to be around the saints, be around the community people, because I believe that it provides growth and development. As a matter of fact, you know, we were made that way. We really were made to be with one another. So the dramatic shift from social nearness to social distance has really been quite an experience for me. You get up some days an automatic thing. You need to bathe and put on your clothes and move out when you got to be in the house. Got to be in the house. So the whole matter of reprogramming your mind and put together a different daily program and becoming more virtual. These are some of the plans or moves that I actually had to make in terms of migrating from what I was accustomed to into this kind of reality. And of course, you do it under the looming shadow of COVID-19, because there is so much talk about it, and you're trying not just to save your own life, you're trying to save other people's lives. So it's that kind of life now. It's staying indoors, but the downside has its upside, right? There is an opportunity to really enrich and build your relationship with your family members, have more time to talk, do things together. I think it's new, but it's all a part of not just creating things to do, but really going back to things people used to do. And that is sit down and have meals together and eat and pray and talk.
I'm not sure about that, but Pastor Duncan, you want to chime in?
Yeah. Thanks, Pastor Green. Yeah, so Dr. Joseph.
Pastor Joseph, your fan in the background is muffling your speech. So if you could address that as best as you can. Yes, Pastor Duncan.
Thanks, Pastor Green, and those who are viewing this Zoom interview. It has impacted me in the ways that it would have impacted others. But there is something that came out at me as it relates to this pandemic and ministry. Our church preaches and teaches and believes in a future time of trouble. However,
our church, bring that in context. What do you mean by our
church? The Seventh-day Adventist Church. So we preach, we teach, we believe in the time of trouble. But this COVID-19 situation, it drove home the reality to me that our pastors, us as pastors, we haven't been taught, we aren't prepared to relate to situations like these. We basically have to improvise. For instance, we weren't taught how to pastor in the seminary. The seminary didn't prepare us to pastor in this context. The church manual, I glanced again through the church manual. The church manual or the pastor's handbook offers no tip or advice to cope with situations like these. So it's a lot of, apart from, as Pastor mentioned, the how he has been relating, and the same for me in a more personal context, but regarding adjusting to pastoral ministry, putting this everything in perspective as it relates to pastoral ministry, it's a whole new different shift, and we have to improvise and do our best using mediums like these, social media, phone calls, more reaching out to members, etc. And again, we weren't prepared in the seminary for this. The church manual and the pastor's handbook is also silent.
Yes. So I see you become very personal as a pastor, how it impacts you. But we are all a part of a family. Most persons live with families. Of course, we know there are persons who live by themselves. But I want to relate to that aspect of the families. I know though that's the area, in fact, that both of you are, you know, keen in. As Pastor Dr. Joseph, your emphasis is in the area of spiritually equipping families. And of course, I know Pastor Duncan, you're looking at the families as well. So families are now spending more time together than before. it's no longer morning and evening, but it's 24/7. And this can lead to tension and all different kinds of things in that kind of environment. So the question that comes to my mind is, what practical or biblical or even sociological advice that you can give to families who are now in this kind of situation where they're packed together in each other's space, as it were, for 24/7?
Well, the thing is that these situations, mega situations when they happen, right, always affect family. For instance, if you go back to the world wars, one and two, it affect families. You look at the 1918 Spanish flu, right? It affect our families. You're looking at the Great Depression in 1939. It's going, everything that has historical proportions that move history and affect the world, right? They also affect families. The challenge is now, this is the challenge. The movements that change families, right? The movement that, for instance, look at the Industrial Revolution, for instance, where you had to deal with urbanization, like the family now ceased to become a productive unit, and families have to, fathers have to go out and work in the factories. And so the family was split and it became more a consumer unit. Okay, now all that happened, but then guess what? The Great Depression comes. So these things come when the family is at its weakest. With the great movements of history, they normally come when the family is at its weakest. So COVID-19 has come, right? And the family is not in good shape, right? Because great movements, right, have created serious separation in the family. For instance, no indication of, no intent of mine to bash any people group or what they believe. But look, when you look at critical theory, for instance, you look at right? And the role of feminism in terms of saying, well, the home is a jail for the women, right? And the women need more expression and they need to be out and they need to work. Let me find, right, okay. And so we find now tension, right, in the family between husband and wife. Tension in the family. As you said, also, you may have single people who are single and so on. So you find quite a bit of tension. And now a dramatic move, right? It's something that the world didn't prepare for, right? And the truth is, even in ministry, as our Pastor Ashley was saying, you could have the unknown and the unpredictable come to you, right? That's it. It happened to John the Revelator. The unknown and the unpredictable came to him when he was age 90. He had to be put into hard labor over in Patmos. So here we are now. Many families have to deal with this, right? At a position of weakness. And the position of weakness may not just be relationship-wise, but maybe finances, maybe a bunch of bills to be paid, right? And so you're going to find now some situations in the, although people would be happy to be together, they have to be thinking now, how are we going to get our children through school? How are we going to pay our mortgage? What's going to happen when this is over? Will we be working again, right? So the family is affected severely. And I believe the family, again, is being attacked at a point when the family is really not strong.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, that's true. That's true, Pastor Green, Pastor Dr. Joseph. Now, I just want to give a few tips, advice, because a lot of people, as Dr. Joseph said, they're finding it hard. They're finding it hard to cope. They are not accustomed to sharing space for so long. And that could cause tension because they're just not accustomed to it. They're not accustomed to the children being around for such an extended period of time. So you're gonna find parents, especially parents with younger children, you're gonna find that your children are going to become more clingy. Mm-hmm. You will find that they're going to yearn more attention, more cuddling, etc. And it's kind of difficult for you to keep things together because you might not have yet a proper schedule, right? First, let me deal with what is happening in the minds of the children. We have to understand that the children, I'm speaking to the children, speaking to those under 13, right? You have to understand that what is going on in their mind, or under 12, what's going on in their minds right now? They are pretty much aware of what is happening, but for the most part, it's internalized. So they are afraid.
Yes.
So the children are afraid. So because of that, you're going to find that they are more clingy. They want to sleep in your bed. You find that they are accompanying you to the bathroom, right? You don't want to push them aside, and you don't want to insult them and to be abrasive and aggressive with them. What you'd want to do, you'd want to have a conversation with them, and you want to assure them that you are there to protect them, because this could have long-lasting psychological impact on the children if it is not dealt with properly. Now, you also would want to have a proper schedule in your home for your children. Now, it might not be as rigid as when they are at school, right? But the schedule is necessary. So they know that this time is prayer time. They know what time is school. And they know what time is bedtime. Regarding the context now with the marital context, husbands and wives now must seize this opportunity to grow closer to God and closer to each other, because this situation like this can either make your relationship stronger or it can tear you apart. So you should, the opportunity should be seized to relate better with each other, give compliments, and focus more on the positives, right? Mm-hmm. If you're having a discussion that is becoming stressful, it's best for you to postpone that discussion. If you're having a discussion about finances, and it's causing too much tension, change that conversation and have a more wholesome discussion, right? Because the children are there, you don't want them caught in the midst of the crossfire, and at the same time you have your marriage and your family to protect.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I just want to continue the tenor of that submission by Pastor Asher. Many times in these situations, right, children are automatically sometimes left out. And I'm happy that he brought the children in. The point I want to add here is the whole idea of modeling, right? Because the truth is, the most effective way of even learning faith is experience, right? And what children experience in the home pretty much is going to make them not just now but in the future. So the guardians or parents, whoever the leaders are in the home, must understand that even it's inadvertent, they must understand at all times, right, that they are modeling. Whatever they are teaching, the children, they are modeling. And I'm happy that Pastor Asha spoke about the idea of delaying certain conversations that may involve certain tension. Because, you see, you don't want the children to conflate what's happening there with what is happening with COVID-19. So everything becomes a full house of fear.
Yes.
Right. So the modeling is going to be very, very, Pastor Asher made a very sound contribution in terms of helping parents to really walk their children through this by important conversations.
Yes. Yes.
Before we move on, Pastor,
right.
We left out a specific group. I just want to touch on it quickly. We spoke to the younger children. I just want to give a quick tip now as it relates to teenagers and adolescents. So teenagers who are in high school and those who would have gone, and adolescents, those who would have gone after college, they are now home, right? It's important for the parents to know that the teenagers and adolescents, they are not there on vacation. So they are at school. So you would want to give them their space, right? You don't want they are around their computers doing their schoolwork. You don't want to send them to the supermarket, right? You're speaking loudly, they can't concentrate, right? These people, they are at school. And they have assignments that are due. So parents would want to give them a certain level of space, a certain level of respect, right? As they try to navigate through this stage of their academic life.
A young man came home from college and told his parents, listen, I know whenever I come home, I'm normally helping and working, but this time I'm coming home to school. I'm coming home to school, right? So in the conversation, right, in the conversation, you know, the college students and the adolescents, right, must assert themselves in that conversation and declare, listen, I'm in school. Because again, patterns in the mind take time to change, right? And so it's going to be more of an interaction to move things along.
If we're not careful, right, within that same tight context, the tendency can supersede in the family circle, where persons are being siloed to their different space,
right?
And something that they could have benefited from, they missed out on. Because let's face it, families has not spent enough time together as they are to. So what are some of the things, suggestions that you could give to families that they could do together in this time?
In terms of intergenerational relationships, right? I really think that there are lots of assets right now that for intergenerational happiness. Right. If you look at spiritually, right, the generations can come together for worship and prayer, come together for the study of the word. Right. If you look at fun and play, right, you find board games or video games or whatever, everybody learning. To me, to me, right, everything is, if the older generation doesn't understand what is going on in this virtual world, then the younger generation must now let them know this is virtual for dummies, right? So listen, everybody got to come on board, because according to Moses, we are not leaving anybody behind. We are going out with our children, our sons, our daughters, everybody coming, right? Yes. So I'm saying these are times when we can have some happy times, and even in the homes, right? Some old games that require physical movements, up and down, hide and seek, and right. These are old games, because the video games folk may not really understand those kind of games, right? But I mean, this is the time eating together, right? Cooking together, washing dishes together. I mean, we have a lot of intergenerational stuff that can actually take place right now.
Yes.
If you have a garden outside,
I like that. Even before Pastor Duncan gets on, the whole idea, it really right now, because most family is consist of an intergenerational gathering. Look at the different generations. So if each family member comes into the family circle, believe it, guess what? There's something that I can offer in this environment.
Yes.
I am just a child, but guess what? I can teach the new dance out there, right? I am a Gen Z, so guess what? Mommy, come, let me show you how where half of the world is at. Let me show you how to get onto social cyber world. And going back to some of the old things, little Uno. Of course, you talk about the importance of the stake of passing on of faith transmission. You relate to that. So those are important. And I just want to re-emphasize it, because I believe it's very important. Thank you, Pastor Joseph. Pastor Duncan.
Yeah, both of you said it all. It's what is important in these times, right, as we adjust to this new normal, right, is protecting the sanity of each family member, right? It's that's what should be forefront in our minds, especially adults. We have to protect the sanity of each family member. So, because the level of interaction that is missing right now, the family has to substitute, right, has to chip in and to substitute for the interaction that is missing on the outside, right? Yes. So every family member must seek to understand the context of the other family, the other members of the family. So you said it right. Sometimes it's board games, and sometimes the adults, the more senior folks, have to learn how to play video games. because each one. I mean, I have a friend, a ministerial colleague who told me a few years ago that he would never join Facebook. He said to me, he'll never join Facebook.
Green, who's that boy?
And I see COVID-19 forcing people onto social media who I never thought would be on social media. So everything is important at these times, from the Uno games to the domino games to the video games, right? So getting the family together socially and protecting the sanity of each family member.
Listen, Pastor Green, sanity and interaction, right? These are powerful concepts. I guess we have to probably come back on these some time ago. Sanity and interaction. These are two powerful correlates, right? Because listen, the children used to be at school and they had their friends, right? And they were talking and playing and right, they spent a lot of time, even though when they came home, they, you know, might have gone on online and whatever, but at least they had some hours with one another, right? And they interact and all of that. In the house where the husband and wife were working, right? I mean, both went out, have interactions and so on outside. Now, guess what? All the deficit of interaction that we have now, because you have none of them out, all of them gonna take place in the home, right? And if you have a man who doesn't like to talk much, and he has a wife, right, that talks a lot, right? And you have all this deficit of interaction now coming into the house. It's gonna require some patience and some learning, because interaction is gonna be necessary for your sanity.
Yes. I appreciate that. There's so many things that you said just now that it's just so even personal. Earlier, Dr. Joseph, you relate to that the family is facing this at a time where it has not been prepared.
Precisely.
Amen. You know, so the first thing I believe we need to do is to face that reality. Mm-hmm. And from that reality, we can then move into the other areas and stimulate growth.
Very important.
For example, Pastor Duncan, you have just speak on the issue of timetabling. Because it's so easy for time to just run away. I could not believe that last ended up to be ending in the next right? So that's what I'm talking about. Last night I was up pretty late trying to get some other works out because the week end and I did not do certain writing, certain studies, get through my sermons, get it to PowerPoint and so forth. So I was up more later than the usual. So timetabling in, I see you're saying that that's very important for the family.
Very good point.
Mm-hmm. Another question that is on my mind, and I haven't seen any as yet from the social media, from Facebook, but a lot of persons are commenting and they are really being benefited from this conversation. But how can one find hope? Because right now, persons are losing hope. How can one find hope in this current COVID-19 situation? I reach a point where I'm like, come on, every day something else, persons are broken to the core. So how can individuals find hope in this time?
There are times in life when we are dealing with something that is bigger than ourselves, right? And humility is going to be important, right? Right now, we are part of a war against an unpredictable and unknown enemy. And it's bigger than ourselves, right? Hope, human beings, right, were born with that desire to reach out to God. Every human being was born with a desire to reach out to transcendence. Right? So this is why when you cut your hand, you said, oh my God.
It's in your mouth.
Right? Because we human beings are born with that desire to reach out to transcendence. Okay. So in the book of Genesis, God created man in his own image. Right? Man was created with hope. His relationship with God.
Yes.
Will take him through.
Mm-hmm.
The presence of God will be what he needs for his emergency. Mm. So when Adam sinned and Eve sinned and they felt hopeless, Right when God came in the garden and asked them questions that he already knew the answers for, he just wanted them to understand where they are, right? Or where they were, right? God gave them hope. He gave them hope that somebody was going to come. Genesis chapter 3, 15, right? He speaks about the seed of the woman would come, right? And would be able to conquer the serpent, right? That happened at the cross. So from Genesis, right, God's people have had hope. Even after sin, right, hope all through the sanctuary, all through the covenants, all through the cross. Yes. And now Jesus, when he left, said, I will come again. One of the things that we have to understand is that the unpredictable and unknown that come into our family and come into our homes, right? They must be seen against the backdrop of God's bigger movement in the world. Mm. And the bigger movement of God in the world, we have seen that through prophecy, where we see empires come and empires go. But it's leading to an eternal kingdom, right? Yeah. So when we are going through our tough times and we say, you know what? Boy, I don't know where I'm going to end up with this. We don't go down hopeless. We bring God's presence and God's big movements in the world to give us an understanding that beyond this is an eternal kingdom that God has prepared for us, and history is moving in that direction. And this unpredictable and this unknown, right, come, but we have hope because God has made provision for this emergency, and the provision he has made for this emergency is really his presence. He will never leave us nor forsake us. And he's leading us to the home that he has gone to prepare for us. And that's how we have to approach this, because we don't even know what's going to happen next week. We don't know who's going to die. We don't know what's going to come to our house. But we as God's people have the capacity to reach out to transcendence.
Yes. Yes. So you're saying it is in us. It is in us to reach out. Yes, I appreciate that. Yes. Pastor Duncan.
Yeah. What's happening now in the world, right?
Yeah.
We have a lot of people who aren't professionally trained to deal with trauma. They have to be absorbing trauma.
Yeah.
No. So folks now start thinking all kind of things. What will happen to me? How am I going to face it? I might lose my job. I have lost my job. And a lot of things. You're just processing a lot of things, and it's just bad things you're processing. Now, first and foremost, right? I want to assure folks of a reality, and Dr. Joseph made mention of it. Now, all of us, we are human beings. Beings meaning that we can change. Beings meaning that we have the potential to reorientate our minds, to regroup, to reshape, to adapt to a new way of life. Mm-hmm. So don't get scared. Don't get scared because you're thinking, I wonder if I can adjust. I wonder if it's possible for me to live without this thing. Or to live with this thing, whatever it is. Just people are afraid of. The main fear right now is people making changes. That is the main fear, right? How quick can I adjust and adapt to this thing and make changes? So the next thing, right, is that we have to go back to what Jesus said, and he said it in his word. Don't lay your treasures on earth, don't do it. Do not lay your treasures on earth. Everything on earth is temporary. It is fleeting. Don't trust anything on earth. Because wherever your treasure, that's where your heart is going to be. Wherever your heart is, that's what's going to cause you to worry about stuff, because that is where your heart is. So those who would have lived successful lives, those in Christendom, outside of Christendom, you would have lived successful lives. You had a good business going for you. I mean, even us as pastors, right? We all around the world, we are hearing scary things, because if there's not faithfulness in the pews, right, we are going to be in trouble. And if folks might not have the resources to be faithful, nobody now should lay the treasure on earth. Moss and rust will corrupt. Times like these, we have to, number one, the first thing that we need to do in an effort to embrace hope is, number one, be grateful. Be grateful.
Yeah.
We are still above the earth. We are still existing. We have family members around us. We still have access to the basic commodities of life. We have a lot to give God thanks for. Yeah. So don't focus on the stuff that you are losing or would have lost. Be grateful. That is number one, gratefulness. Yes. Number two, always remember that God is in control. God is in control, and God will see us through. There are some things you can't do anything about. What is important, what keeps us together is our trust. What keeps our sanity is our trust in God.
Amen. Amen. Yes. I appreciate those. The fact that we cannot be so earthly focused, because everything on earth, and think about it. You get a promotion yesterday, but today, because it's lockdown, you can't go in the office that you wanted so long, right? So because of that, now individuals.
Yeah, you know, I share something as possibly, yeah, right? Yeah. On the same day. Yeah. So I was speaking with a colleague the other day, a ministerial colleague, and we're talking about the live stream. So he said something about larger churches and smaller churches. I said, hey, hold up. Because right now, there's no large church and small church.
No.
All of a sudden, there's no large church, small church. Everybody know, right? You go, right? You're speaking through social media, right? Everything could just change. So it comes back down to the same thing. You could have everything today, and the next second, everything has changed. And this is what is the most shocking thing about COVID-19. It was so sudden. We got no chance to prepare for it. It was so sudden. You try this week, the next week you hear everything locked down. So sudden. Our hope is only in Jesus Christ.
Yeah, and it's a leveling of the social playing field. What was said earlier, I think, deserves to be highlighted. The whole matter of hope and meaning, because when you have hope, what you have is meaning, right? And if you find ultimate meaning in your job, or ultimate meaning in your position, or ultimate meaning in your popularity, because right now the NBA playing, what you call that, where they play?
Season. NBA
no,
season.
Not the season, man. The place they play in. The
stadiums. Stadiums.
Right. Oh, stadium. Yeah. Right. They are empty, right? They are empty. So if you find meaning, if your ultimate meaning for you is playing for these fans, right, so that you could feel a certain way, and if that's where you have ultimate meaning, right, when this thing begins to slip away from you, right, where your treasure is, right, then you're going to have heart problems, right? So it's important that we build our hope on things eternal, right? Yeah. Build our hope on things eternal. That is what is going to get us through moments like this one when we are dealing with the unpredictable and the unknown. Build your hope on things eternal. You know, God is in complete control, as Pastor Asher said, right? He's in complete control. He's doing his work in the world.
Yes.
God is not absent. God has a plan, and he's moving his plan towards a glorious climax. And that's where our treasure should be.
Yes.
In God.
Yes.
And what God is doing.
Yes, yes, Dr. Joseph. You know, because you know, this COVID-19 is real to me, my family and my kids. Before, you know, I read about World War, Spanish flu and stuff, and what I normally use them to do is to divide history. But here it is that as I'm looking at it, I said, you know, these things happen. They are not really divided in history. They are real things that happen to people, that causes people to really lose hope sometimes, lose their head.
Uh-huh. Sure.
So the point that both of you have made to this question, I don't want those who are following us to lose it, is that God meets you where you are. And throughout history, we have always seen that God always meets his people in the time of adversity. When Adam and Eve were in their adversity, God met them. The antediluvian world, God met Noah. And throughout that, we see that in individual cases, we see that God met individuals. From Daniel in the lions, then to John on the Isle of Patmos. So God always meets people. So we can have hope, then, both of you are saying, in the fact that Jesus is very much in touch with what is happening here on this earth.
Yes, sir. That's right.
Amen. Amen. And another question, because we have about 10 minutes or so remaining. Another question that is running through my mind is this. Comes in a question, in a statement. I am burnt out from the information, the theories, the messages, etc., that comes with COVID-19 on my WhatsApp, on my Google search, where I go. I'm bombarded with all kind of stuff, and I am burnt out. Is this statement a possibility? And if so, what do I need? Yes.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yep.
Yes, Pastor Jay. One of the healing remedies of life is something called abstemiousness, right? It's moderation. It's balance, right? Yeah. And that's what we are going to have to use to approach what you call an environment that it's not just COVID-19. It has always been an environment where there is over communication, right? It's a lot of communication, and the truth is some of them are fake news, right? So what you do, you have, first of all, you have to get credible information, right? You have to look at credible sources. Where are the credible sources? Are known to be credible sources. Where you have information that is valid, reliable, and trustworthy, right?
Yeah.
We that is going to help you, right? Okay, you have to balance your life in terms of not spending an extraordinary amount of hours on Facebook and other social media platforms, and you're getting the same information coming back to you. You know what kind of bothers me, particularly with WhatsApp, it's when 10 people sending me the same video, taking up all my space and thing on my, that really annoyed me, but the same thing over and over, right? But that's just the reality of where we are. So you, here now with personal responsibility, say to yourself, I want to live, I want to be sane, as Pastor Asher was saying, so I got to balance, I need to be balanced. Yeah. I'm going to have a portion of you, I'm going to take a portion of this, I'm going to take a portion of that, right? You have to be balanced. And in the process, if the presence of God and the bigger mega movements of God, in terms of you seeing the big picture, is important to you, you can't spend more time on COVID-19 than you spend in your Bible, right? Mm. Or you spend in the presence of God.
Yes.
Because it's going to affect your brain. No. If that's all you're focusing on, it's going to affect your brain, right? So I'm saying balance is going to be very important.
Yeah. Amen.
There's in dealing with these things, right? You have to process things, right? Now there are some folks who have a greater potential in processing things and picking sense out of nonsense more than others, right? But there are some consistent questions that must be answered, right? The first question that you need to ask yourself is did Jesus prophesy these things, right? wherever it's coming from, we don't know. We don't know, is it man-made, is it natural, is it 5G, whatever. Those are secondary, right? Was it prophesied? Were pandemics prophesied? Did Jesus speak about it, right? Yes. The next question you need to ask is this thing real? Is COVID-19, is it real? You have to ask yourself that question, right? Is it real? You look around, you realize something is happening. It's real, right? Is COVID-19 the end of the world? Now, this is the question that people must contemplate and answer. Is it the end of the world? No. Mm. Right? It's not the end of the world. COVID-19 won't wipe everybody out and everybody die and then that's it. No, the Bible teaches that Jesus Christ is coming again. This is just one of the signs, pandemics, right? And the next question, will COVID go? Yes. COVID-19 will go and it will be history, right? Yep. The next question that it comes home now, and those who are watching, I hope you're writing these things down, right? The next thing I want to ask yourself, am I coping? Evaluate yourself. Am I coping? Am I having headaches? Am I too worried, right? Am I coping, right? Now, if your answer is no, you have to find out why you're not coping. Pretty much, very, 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 very likely the reason for you not coping is because of what is called information overload. So mm-hmm. you're reading every WhatsApp, you are watching every video, right? You're trying to process everything, and you are trying to find out what is really happening, right? What is really happening? What's the source of this thing? What is really happening? You won't find out. That's the reality. We won't find out. Right? Yes. So digging is just going to make you more uncomfortable, more miserable, more confused, right? And then what you're doing now, you're making yourself more susceptible to this disease, because when you cause yourself to experience more fear and stress, you are weakening your immune system. And in weakening your immune system, you become more likely to contract the disease.
Hello.
Right? So you must ask yourself these questions, right? And understand that these are the relevant questions. Now, with that said, if you are mature enough to read through things and to analyze things properly, and you realize that you are coping, fine. But I'm sending a warning, and I'm beseeching people who are listening. If you, whenever you see these theories or whatever, you find yourself getting nervous and afraid, and you have a slight headache, means that your pressure is a little bit elevated.
Your
heart starts to race. I am advising you, please avoid such things. If you, when you watch the news, this is the way you feel, you don't have to watch the news. Avoid certain things because you have to protect your sanity, and you want to survive, right? So if this thing is not helping you to survive, leave them alone.
Yes. Amen. Pastor Green.
Yes.
Let me just give, I hope the audience wrote down those things. I want to give a visual, right? Just an image, just to support those questions. Just an image. I know you guys are
graphics.
Gen Z. You guys are Gen Z, right?
Yes. All right.
Okay, I'm over in the X, right?
We're millennials.
So I hope you guys understand what I'm going to say. Back in my day, right, when you had a notebook, they still have a notebook, right, where you had a red line, and it used to call the margin. Y'all know about that, right? No. Right. Anytime you wrote in the margin, the teacher used to beat you on your hand. Right?
Yeah.
Or you were penalized somehow. You're not supposed to write in the margin. Right?
Yeah.
Now, if the people follow what was just said by Pastor Asher, right? They will stay out of the margin.
Yes.
Right? If they don't listen, they're gonna end up in the margin. And when you end up in the margin, you are losing resources emotionally, intellectually, physically. You're becoming sick because you are going beyond the boundary, right? Yes. So I hope that people understand clearly, right, the whole call today, right, not to go over in the margins, right?
Yeah.
Just live your life in moderation.
I see Cello Longley this word. Balance.
Yes.
And that's it. If you know your phone is going to be overloaded with all these videos, you need to know how to block certain things from coming.
Yes.
And if you don't know, call a Gen Z.
Ask questions.
But I really appreciate the discussion. We're virtually out of time. Would you believe it? But it has been a good discussion, Dr. Joseph and Pastor Duncan. Honestly, what you have given today, it has been a really, really good plate of blessing for me. And I know also for the viewing audience, as I am seeing the live interaction. But as we end, before COVID-19, people have been facing some real challenges. This, it just added to the amount of things that people are grappling with every day, whether it is relationals, whether it is sociological, whether it is financial, and whatever it is. So people have been dealing with these things, them and their families, some people alone. So the question as we pull out is, what can you Zoom, what kind of hope you can Zoom to the listening audience, those who are live now and those who will view even after we're through? What can you Zoom out as it relates to hope to?
You want me to go first? Okay.
Yeah.
I would say, right, that human beings had a meaningful beginning.
Yes.
A meaningful beginning. The Bible says God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male, male, female. So human beings had a meaningful beginning. God has made provision for every emergency, and the provision is his presence. He's the eternal God. Before we got here, God was here. He's Alpha, he's Omega, he's the beginning, he's the ending. So God has not forgotten our meaningful beginning. History will have a meaningful ending. It will not end with COVID-19, as Pastor Asher said. It's going to have a meaningful ending. And the meaningful ending is the second coming of Christ.
Yes.
And the ushering in of the eternal kingdom of God, where there'll be no more disease, no more pain, no more suffering, no more COVID-19. That's the big picture in the midst of our trials that I want the audience to leave here with.
Amen. Thank you so much. That's powerful. I appreciate that. Pastor Duncan.
Yeah, just to follow up, right? If we take our Bibles, right?
Yes.
Just look at this Bible here. At the beginning of the Bible, Genesis, at the beginning of the Bible, you see where we see creation and the fall. Going through in the middle of the Bible, we see God's plan to restore humanity after the fall, all through.
Mm-hmm.
When, by the time we get to the end, we see where humanity is restored to where God wants us to be. Mm-hmm. So I would tell people, anchor yourself in the Word of God.
Yes, sir.
Anchor yourselves in the Word of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, gentlemen. My mentor, Dr. Joseph, friend and comrade, and go-to guy, Asher, Dane Duncan, both of you, doctor and pastor, as you contributed beautiful ways, so much knowledge. I appreciate you, appreciate the interaction, and I pray that God will bless you. So for those of you who are, you know, caught between and hopelessness, and you're trying to make sense in out of what, just trust God. He not only have this, he have you. And you're in God's hands. You have nothing to fear but fear itself. This thing will come to an end. Don't allow Satan to distract you in the storm. Keep your eyes upon Jesus and look full, as the song says, in his wonderful things of this world. Yes, COVID-19 and all of these things, they will go strangely dim, because the anchor holds in the time of storm. Thank you so much for joining us, and you will see us again next week with this discussion, more discussion, as it relates to how to cope in this time, in times of the storm. God bless you, and have a wonderful
day. Amen.
Yeah, I'm gonna push out now, y'all.